afternoon. Tradune.
Glue is cheap.
Thank you.
Tredune.
You know, there's a new awareness sweeping the world these days. Call it peace, call it love, call it flower power. We just call it the hottest sound across the Atlantic since Mrs. Murphy's chowder. They're from England, and don't let the name scare you. They're full of love. Please welcome Spinal Tap.
The past and the present come together when Johnny Cash enters this jail.
Dinosaurs lived a long time ago. They were terrible lizards, don't you know? Some ate plants and some ate meat. Some ate fish and some ate beets. One was called a Diplodocus. One was bigger than your school bus. One was called a Triceratops. Three horns to stop anything it hops. Now, can't you just see yourself walking along, leading your pet Trachodon, or feeding your Brontosaurus Rex, or scratching your Diplodocus neck, or riding on a Stegosaurus back, or swimming in a Brachiosaurus track? Oh, what a time and oh, what fun playing tag with your Iguanodon. And if we had dinosaurs now, could they get along with a horse and a cow? Well, I wish they hadn't have become extinct. Dinosaurs would be nice pets and friends to have around to run outside and play with every day, don't you think?
Everybody, and welcome back to Paleontologizing. A very happy National Flower Day to one and all. We're going to be talking about the origin and evolution of flowers and how they may have helped shape dinosaur evolution, or maybe vice versa, too. And then, of course, we're going to have Thursday Birds Day later. It is going to be a jam-packed stream. I'm glad you're here early. I had to start early because I've got to be on the road by, like, 2 p.m. today. Going on a little trip, so, early start and early end to the stream. But I'm glad you're here. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. If it's anybody's very first stream today, then you picked an odd one to be your first, but I'm glad you're here. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. I'm here on Twitch trying to do some good old-fashioned science outreach. So talking about my own scientific field as a dinosaur paleontologist, dinosaurs are what I work on. What I study, what I publish on in the scientific literature, what I dig up during the summers. We're gearing up to go dig up some more dinosaurs at the end of May, maybe even sooner than that. But I'm going to be broadcasting that live from the field like I did last summer, too. So, if that sounds cool to you, stick around.
The dinosaur, this was a subtropical delta, home of the big plant eaters, and of the monsters who chased them.
Like you, Varning. Thank you for the 6 months of support.
Paleobirds are dinos 3.
You're not a monster, you are a longtime supporter of this channel now for 6 months. Thank you, Farning. I appreciate you. Thank you for helping keep me online for the past 6 months. Appreciate you. Yeah, as a dinosaur paleontologist, dinosaurs are what I work on, what I dig up, and these broadcasts are my way of trying to do outreach, trying to answer people's questions, trying to peel back the curtain, show you how paleontology works. That's why we call it paleontologizing. Dormir Bell, thank you for those 5 gift subs. I do really appreciate that. Thank you. Good stuff. Holy cow, Dormir. There are 5 people in the chat.
Things with those 5 gift subs.
5 people in the chat who, thanks to your generosity, won't have to worry about any ads the next month. So thank you for that. Holy cow. Belle, I really appreciate it. Welcome back. I hope you're having a good day. Happy National Flower Day to you. Where was I? Oh, yeah. As a paleontologist, fossils are what I study. This is my means of doing outreach. We call it paleontologizing here because I'm trying to get the idea across that paleontology isn't just like a dusty book on a shelf somewhere. It's a process. It's an active field of research, and I wanna show you how it's done. So we're taking paleontology, thinking of it, but it less as a noun and more as a verb.
Alan.
Thanks to @A_Truck_Horn for my sub gift.
And Paleo Kent, hang on, is this? Thank you for the 8 months of support right there in a truck horn. Thank you for gifting Paleo Kent. That's not Ken from the field, is it? Ken, did you change your username? yeah. Showing that science is fun, says Fedora Sor. Well, I'm glad. I'm glad you have fun with it. That's kind of the point, you know? Paleontology is fun. To a certain extent, it can be hard work also, but we who become paleontologists, we who do paleontology, do it because we're passionate about it, because we're fascinated with the history of life on Earth and the perspective that it gives us about our everyday lives, about where things came from and about where they're going. If you don't have an understanding of the history of life on Earth, you don't understand life on Earth in the present. And that's kind of what we're talking about today for National Flower Time. So, good stuff. So happy National Flower Day to you. Apparently there's like 3 different National Flower Days. We just happen to pick one that's convenient for us. But, I could get started and say hello to everybody in the chat, but we're really pressed for time today. And so we are going to just jump into our subject matter, because we've got to do this, and we've got to do Thursday Birds Day, all within the span of, what, less than 3 hours now? Holy cow, 2 hours, 15 minutes, something like that? Oh boy. Paleo Ken, thank you for those 100 bits. Appreciate that. I really do. And, oh, this is the same Ken, because you got that moderator sword. Ken, it's good to see you. I hope you're doing well. Howdy, howdy. Oh, you're going to be joining us again in Wyoming, aren't you, Ken? I'm excited for that. Nell says, we can always have Birds Day as Friday Flies Day. I'm not streaming tomorrow. This is the last stream of the week. I'm going on a little trip today and tomorrow. So, that's why we've got to get everything done today. National Flower Day. Let's see here. Not National Plant a Flower Day. Goodness. Well, yeah, there's National Flower Day, March 21st. 3 ways to celebrate flowers. We're going to ignore most of these. And we're going to talk about the origin of flowers. I think a lot of people don't realize, in the general public, maybe because we're not very good at communicating these ideas as paleontologists, that for the first half of their reign, the first half of the Age of Dinosaurs, there were no flowers. There were no grasses. There were no plants with big fruiting bodies. There were no angiosperms, is what I'm trying to say. Angiosperm is a term that we're going to talk about a lot today. You are constantly going to hear this term. Flowering plants are plants that bear fruits and flowers and form the clade Angiospermae. Angiosperms are the flowering plants. From water lilies to buttercups, from grasses to apples.
A dinosaur?
What? And Tesma, how are you doing? Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Oh, and very cool. You got the last week of June office vacation, be able to spend the whole week? Awesome, Ken. Oh, I can't wait. And you know, the end of the month is when we're gonna need the most help, too, so that is brilliant. I can't wait to see it, Ken. Oh! I'm excited. Good stuff. And, oh, that is gruesome. Fatality. Jonathan's 1992. Crazy.
Glad to be here.
I'm glad you're here too. Holy cow, thank you for supporting me for the past 2 years. Holy moly. Appreciate you. And Tesma says, hello, thanks. I'm a big fossil hunting nerd out in Appalachia. Oh, very cool. Tesma, well, welcome to Paleontologizing. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist, and we're celebrating National Flower Day today, hence the artificial lay here. And the flowers in the background as well. what kind of fossils do you find out there in Appalachia? A lot of that stuff is going to be Paleozoic, right? So the big orogenic event was happening to push up the Appalachian Mountains. Maybe like Newark Supergroup rocks, or maybe that's further east and north up near like New York. Anyway, cool. I bet you're finding trilobites and brachiopods and crinoids and all kinds of cool stuff. It's good to have you here, Tasma. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Cephalime says, Oh, A Pile of Lint says, thank you very much for the gifted sub. A Pile of Lint, what a great name. Glad you got a gift sub. Welcome. Cephalim, thank you for gifting Tesma. I appreciate that very much. Thank you, Cephalim. Wonderful. Cephalim asked, wasn't there no grass for most of the dinosaurs' existence? Correct. For the entire Mesozoic, there were no grasses as we think of them today. There may have been a few very quote-unquote primitive grasses, with just a few strands, almost like a bunch grass or something, but they were not widespread. There were no fields of grass during the age of the dinosaurs, during the Mesozoic. Because flowering plants had not evolved yet. And grasses are a kind of flowering plant. Let me show you. Go to our Tree of Life here. And let's jump to the plants. I love showing this because as far as we know, all life on Earth arose from a single common ancestor about 3.8 billion years ago. So, speaking of flower people, like in that song from that we played at the beginning, next time you run into like some hippie guy and he goes, hey man, hey, all life is one, man. He's actually correct in an evolutionary phylogenetic sense. As far as you know, all life on Earth arose from a single common ancestor about 3.8 billion years ago. So that's animals and plants and fungi and protists and everything else. From ladybugs to octopus to quinoa. They all share a common ancestor. Now we'll jump to plants here on the Tree of Life. And there's many, many, many kinds of plants. It's probably close to a million species of plants. This is probably a grievous undercount. But nowadays, the majority of plant species are flowering plants. Magnoliopsida, interesting. Also called angiosperma. The angiosperms are the flowering plants. Almost all of the plants that we eat, from grains like wheat and barley to fruits like apples to vegetables like cucumbers, almost every kind of plant that we eat, with rare few exceptions, is a flowering plant. Which is pretty cool to think about. These did not exist until about halfway through the age of dinosaurs. Let me show you. So we'll go to our International Chronostratigraphic Chart. This is a chart of time on planet Earth. We're up here at the very top, obviously. The Cenozoic era is the age of mammals. Grasses first evolve, I think, somewhere in here, Paleocene, Eocene. Like, that's when they start to actually become recognizable as grasses in the fossil record. Dinosaurs first evolved down here in, like, maybe the end of the middle Triassic here. Excuse me, Triassic. And dinosaurs exist until the end of the Cretaceous. Then all of them go extinct, except for a few species of bird, which later became all of the birds that we have today. We'll be talking about that later on in this broadcast when we get to Thursday Birds Day. But for most of the Mesozoic, there were no flowering plants. Flowering plants seem to first evolve in, like, the Valanginian, I think? In the lower Cretaceous period. So for all this time leading up to here, there were no flowering plants, there were no flowers on planet Earth. So dinosaurs that lived in the Jurassic, like Allosaurus and Stegosaurus, Diplodocus and Brachiosaurus, they would have never seen a flower. Because they don't evolve, flowers don't evolve until about here. Might be, I've heard suggestions maybe Berriasian, but Valanginian is usually one that I hear the most often. Anyway. Yeah. And Red Sledge. Oh, man. We did a big stream about state dinosaurs at one point, didn't we? Paluxysaurus, yeah, is probably a brachiosaur, but we don't really know. We don't know what kind of sauropod in particular it might have been. Oh, maybe, shoot, maybe I don't have that. Oh, well. Paluxysaurus is not super well known. We don't know exactly what kind of sauropod it was.
Spared no expense.
And Golganek, thank you for gifting Red Sledge.
Tier 1 sub to Red Sledge Blue.
I appreciate
that. They have
that.
Given 416 gift subs in the channel.
Thank you, Golganek. I appreciate you. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. And Gooberfish says, so they saw lots of ferns then. Yes. Yes. During the Mesozoic, you know, prior to the early Cretaceous, landscapes would have looked like this. I think this is supposed to be like Jurassic Age England. It looks like a John Sibbick painting. So we've got cycads, we've got ferns, we've got horsetails, we've got club mosses and spike mosses, we've got conifer trees, like monkey puzzle trees or like redwoods. We've got lots and lots and lots of ferns. Yeah. The world would have looked very different. Here, take a look. This is an arboretum somewhere in like the, somewhere in Eastern Europe, I think. But these are the kinds of plants that you would expect to see growing during the Mesozoic. These are plants that are still around today that are very, very similar to the plants that were around back then. Most of these are the same lineages. So lots of lovely ferns like this, horsetails, big old tree ferns like these guys. Yeah. So a world without flowers yet, without grasses, without fruit trees. Look at that big, beautiful cycad with that giant cone in it. Very, very cool. Yeah. And palm trees are actually a kind of flowering plant, Gooberfish. Yeah, palm trees are, they're not what we call gymnosperms. Gymnosperms are non-flowering plants. Angiosperms are flowering plants. So I'm sure when we get into a video in a minute, we'll talk about that. But yeah, yeah. Tesma says, as a boy, exploring the late Triassic rocks of Virginia, I saw a massive car-sized mudstone boulder covered with what I thought were maple leaves. I didn't know enough at the time that these were pre-flowers and impossible. They were dinosaur footprints. Very cool. Hooked on fossils since? That is really, really neat, Tesma. That is really neat. What a wonderful origin story for your interest in fossils. That's... oh, that's cool. That's very cool. I'm glad you're here. You're in the right place. Welcome to Paleontology. And Salamander says, a world without pollen allergies? No, lots of other plants produce pollen too. Pine trees, conifers, also produce pollen. Here, maybe we need a brief, kind of primer on plant phylogeny. Here we go. Yeah! The map of plants. This is good stuff. Here. And holy moly, anonymous gifter! 5 gift subs right there. Cheers, anonymous gifter. Thank you. For being as generous as you are
Anonymous
mysterious.
Anonymous just changed things with those 5 gift subs.
I appreciate that. We have now reached our sub goal for the week.
Myosaurs always ate their vegetables.
And Starling fan, thank you for the follow. Oh, you're here just in time for Thursday Birds Day. In a little bit. That's going to be awesome. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Here. Cheers, anonymous gifter. We have now reached our weekly sub goal. Thank you for that. Holy moly. This is a short week because I'm not streaming tomorrow. Thank you for helping us reach the goal anyway. I really appreciate it. Holy cow. Thank you. Lovely. And Salamit, I'm glad you get it. Good. Okay. Without further ado, let's jump into this video right here because we don't have much time today. This is neat stuff.
This video is sponsored by
to pine trees, all the trees way more closely related to a pumpkin.
Here, hang on a second. Let me get rid of this part. And you know what we'll do here is we'll do that. There we go.
Did you know an oak tree is way more closely related to a pumpkin than they are to pine trees?
Look, here are the oaks next to the pumpkins, and here are the pine trees all the way over here.
Yep, pine trees
Before
are gymnosperms.
Before I made this map, I thought that all of the trees evolved from each other. But it turns out the concept of a tree has evolved throughout history multiple times. In this map of plants video, I'm going to look at all of the different kinds of...
But that general, like, morphological pattern that we call a tree, you know, with like a big woody stem, and then you've got leaves or needles or whatever on top. Those are not all related to each other. Lots of different plant groups have independently evolved that kind of overall pattern, is what he said. Yeah. Convergent evolution, exactly.
They're all related to each other. And I made this video with the help of the experts at the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew here in London. And like all of my map videos, the poster's available on my website, dosmaps.com, as well as all of our Professor AstroCat books. So if you want to get your hands on it, that's where to go.
In this map, I found the most sensible way of organizing all of the plants is by how they've evolved. So this map is really an evolutionary tree of all plant life based on our current understanding.
And camellia,
start at the beginning with the most ancient plants, algae. Algae is a name used to describe a wide range of different unrelated organisms that have the ability to generate energy through photosynthesis, but not all of these are true plants. Algae come in many different sizes, from single-celled varieties to multicellular seaweeds.
Shout out to Diatoms Attack and to Pacific Plankton, who both stream on Twitch, and they show a lot of diatoms in their channel. Holy cow. Yeah. Diatoms Attack. There we go. And Pacific Plankton. Both of them do really excellent science outreach here on Twitch. If you like microscope streams, you will really, really like their work. Very, very chill. Very educational. Diatoms Attack is actually a professional diatomist, so he's... I guess his official title is paleoecologist, but he studies diatoms both extinct and extant. Modern diatoms that are still alive today, and fossil diatoms also. Really, really important group of critters. They might produce like a third to half of the oxygen on Earth. So, yeah. Every breath you take, maybe every two breaths you take, thank a diatom. It would help if I turn the sound back.
Algae aren't just found in salt water. They can be found in fresh water and on land.
Yeah.
Single-celled algae, known as diatoms, and the multicellular brown algae are not considered true plants. Even so, they're very important to life, as three-quarters of the oxygen in the atmosphere is made by tiny single-celled phytoplankton.
Red algae are the first big group of species
considered to be in the plant kingdom under the current taxonomy, containing about 6,000 species. Although there's another small group of around 15 species called glaucophytes, which may also have evolved first, but which one?
I don't want to give the impression, Paul Quantum Fire, that trees are overrated, because they are certainly not. Trees do provide about a quarter of our oxygen, and also they are absolutely fundamental to life on land. There are so many different organisms that rely upon trees. Trees are kind of, well, it's amazing what trees provide for us and how important they are to different ecosystems. So, yeah, in terms of oxygen, though, they're not producing the lion's share of it. That is microscopic oceanic organisms like diatoms. Yeah. Yeah.
Is a plant.
What is a plant?
Technically, it's based on looking at a part of the cells called chloroplasts, which do the photosynthesis.
Can you come up here?
In plants, these chloroplasts are surrounded by two membranes, which scientists think came from an ancient event where one cell ate another, but the cell that got eaten didn't die. They started working together, and we define all plants to have this kind of double membrane chloroplast. And red algae and glaucophytes have the double membrane chloroplast, despite not having things we think are more plant-like, like leaves, roots, or a stem.
Yeah.
The different colours of algae come from the pigments they use to convert sunlight into energy. Green plants all use two types of chlorophyll, known as chlorophyll A and B, and these are the same pigments used by green algae.
Oh, and hello, hello, sweetie pie. How are you doing? You come to investigate the plants today? Yeah, hey, come here, look, I got a treat for you. Right there. Look. Right here. Yeah, that's leftover from yesterday. I tried to entice you over and you ran away. It's been sitting there all night. Oh, there you go. Ladies and gentlemen, sweetie pie. Danger Darren says, I wonder what effect the nitrogen fixation trees accumulate has had on atmospheric composition. Well, slightly less oxygen, or slightly less nitrogen in the atmosphere, more of it fixated in the soil or in their bodies. Danger Darren, that's a great question. Yeah. A lot of questions that we get like that, I'm not going to be super well equipped to answer because I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. I'm stepping a little bit outside my comfort zone today, talking about plants, talking about flowers. But I can tell you that during the age of dinosaurs, a certain group of plants called cycads, which we'll see later on in this map. Cycads, they look like this. They were very, very good at fixing nitrogen, taking nitrogen out of the atmosphere and fixing it into the soil. I don't know if they actually did that themselves or if it was kind of a joint venture between them and various kinds of fungi or bacteria. But, yeah. I'll put my cycad back over here. Yeah. And Michael says, were dinosaurs big because there was more CO2 and more oxygen? No. No, in fact, we even have a command about that. The atmospheric composition of the Mesozoic era, the age of dinosaurs, is not that different from today. In fact, there may have been more carbon in the atmosphere and less oxygen. So if anything, it would have been more of an uphill battle for dinosaurs to get really, really big. But they were able to get really big because of a number of different factors, things that they evolved, their reproductive strategy, their feeding methods, their respiratory systems. Dinosaurs breathed in a much, much, much more efficient way than we mammals do. Especially the saurischian dinosaurs, theropods and sauropods. They had this, like, avian respiratory system that is much, much, much more efficient. And would have made them much more lightweight compared to their size as well. Here's a nice little diagram. This is a sauropod dinosaur, and everything you see in blue is air. These big electric blue air sacs in the animal's torso. The dark blue lung right there. This air sac right here, and then these pneumaticities, these air-filled hollows in the vertebrae. Every time the animal would take a breath, that breath would go into the air sacs, circulate through those, and then from the air sacs go into the lungs, and then from the lungs go up into those pneumaticities in the vertebrae as well. These are... This would be like a wonder of engineering if it were designed, but no, this evolved by a natural means, and this is the same system that birds have today. They inherited this from their ancestors, from their dinosaur ancestors. Birds didn't evolve from the long-necked dinosaurs in particular, but from two-legged meat-eating dinosaurs, much like a velociraptor. There's a decent velociraptor there, fully feathered, as we now know they were. So there you go, yeah, yeah. Good stuff. Yeah. And, oh, and very cool, Tesma. Yeah, ethnobotany paper on cycads and their importance to various cultures in South and Central America. Very cool, Tesma, very cool. We were discussing a paper last night when I did a crossover stream with Balint of Science Streams. Yeah, about how cycads are not actually living fossils. Paper made a very convincing case that I agree heartily with. Pull it up real quick. But the argument is basically that cycads are way too diverse in their morphology, and too different today than they were during the Mesozoic to be considered living fossils. Basically, this big radiation, like all of the diversity that you see in types of cycads today, originated in like the late Cenozoic. These groups did not exist during the Age of Dinosaurs, so they're entirely different lineages. Yeah, yeah. It's cool stuff. See if I can find the paper if anybody's curious. There we go. Nope. That's the one I just showed you. There we go. There's the link. It's in Nature Communications. And it's open access, which everybody loves. Yeah, no paywall. There you go. Yeah. Eddie Scarron, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Yeah. Anyway. And Ice Queen Games, how are you doing? And Miss Yvette. Howdy, howdy. Here, let's get back to our video here and talk about, like, basic plant phylogeny.
Streptophyte algae are a distinct group of green algae, which are thought evidence of algae,
more algae
bacteria called cyanobacteria, an ancestor hornworts and liverworts, and are a crucial part of our understanding of the evolution of plants, as they're considered to be very similar to the earliest land-dwelling organisms on Earth, which started to live on land from around 470 million years ago, around 50 million years before animals. They lack many of the features of more modern plants, like flowers or vascular tissues, which are the parts of plants that transport water and nutrients, like sugars, around the plant. But they do have root-like structures called rhizoids.
And hello, Science Streams.
Bryophytes typically grow in moist, shady environments because they can only collect water and nutrients directly through...
Here, we're getting another Sweetie Pie visit. Hello. How are you doing, Sweetie Pie? Yeah. I think she's doing pretty well. Yeah. And Science Streams, how are you doing? It is good to have you here, Balint. I hope you're having a good day so far. Sweetie Pie, are you having a good day? It looks like you are. Yeah. Yeah, Balint, happy National Flower Day to you. I hope you're having a good one. Lots of silly meetings. That sounds like fun. Oh, maybe not silly in, like, in a fun way. Maybe silly in an unnecessary way. That's not always fun. Oh, look at that big yawn, Sweetie Pie. Yeah. want some flowers, sweetie pie? I know how much you like plants. These aren't real flowers. They're made of synthetic material. I would put it around your neck, but it's not a good idea to put things around cat's necks. So I'm not gonna do that. Yeah. Oh, sweetie. Just being our camera operator right now. I'm streaming later in the day, and Sweetie Pie is like taking a nap or something. Right now, she's all inquisitive and froggy. Yeah, you got some pep in your step, Sweetie Pie. You got some pep in your step. Or in your sit, in this case. Yeah. Look at you looking at the camera. Oh. So cats like this, as we're talking about evolutionary family trees, cats like Sweetie Pie are carnivorous mammals. So they're, in the grand scheme of things, they're pretty close to us as human beings. Like us, they are placental mammals of clade Laurasia Theria. And, I think the most exclusive clade that we share with cats might be Scrotifera. But, yeah, we are pretty close in the grand scheme of things. Haunt me, bye. Yeah. Let's take a look at that. On our tree of life. There we go. Let's jump to good ol' Homo sapiens. That's us. And that's you, Chad. Good stuff. There's us, humans. And then let's jump to domestic cat from here. Not that far away in the grand scheme of things. Just right over there. Yeah. So, Felis catus. You would think that with the, like, millions or hundreds of millions, if not billions, of domestic cats in the world, you would think that they'd be able to get a better photo than that one, but apparently not. Anyway, we'll zoom out from there. We've got the carnivorans. And then, yep, this is the clade that includes... Oh, no, never mind. No, we gotta go down to Boroeutheria. Yeah. So we're both Boroeutherian mammals. So rodents are actually closer to us than cats are. But cats are still pretty close. Gemseer, how are you doing? Thank you for the follow. Rodents, primates, and more form this clade called Eurocontoglires. You take a right, you get to the rodents and rabbits. You take a left, you get to Eucaronta, which includes the primates. There. Yeah. So anyway, the whole point is all of life on Earth is related. And we can trace its origins back to the origins of life on Earth about 3.8 billion years ago. The reason all living things on Earth share certain sequences in their DNA is because it comes from a common ancestor. It's pretty cool to think about. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. And Paleoken says, oh, Scrotifera. Hey, let me show you. Yeah. Clade of placental mammals that groups together grand orders Ferungulata, Chiroptera, and other members of their common ancestor. Extinct members and their common ancestors, yeah. So I don't... It doesn't actually include... primates. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. And I only recently learned this too, Ken. Yeah, yeah. I'm sure Fisher would know this right off the top of his head. Yeah. Oh, and here's Moon Pie. Moon Pie, are you coming to say hello? Moon Pie. Hi. Sweetie Pie. Hey, sweetie. Don't pester Moon Pie. You hear me? Hey. There you go. Sweetie Pie. Don't make me throw a lens cap at you. You be nice to Moon Pie. Okay. Hey, Moon Pie. It's good to see you. Yeah. If we're lucky, maybe Moon Pie will make an appearance, too. In fact, I think she might. She's extending a paw like she wants to come up on my lap. We'll see her. I'm going to pretend like I'm ignoring her, and here she is. Moon Pie. Yeah. Well, we're 2 for 3 so far. Moon Pie, how are you doing? You press the cat cam button. There you are. Hello, Moon Pie. Yeah. How are you doing? You having a good day also? I'm streaming earlier than usual. You know, your schedule's all thrown off, huh? Yeah. Oh, well, good to see you, Moon Pie. Yeah. Oh. She's operating the camera also. Yeah. Don't sneeze in my ice water, please. She loves to investigate the plants. Don't you, Moon Pie? Don't you? You want some cuddles? Oh, hello. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, 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 oh. Yeah, Moon Pie. Happy National Flower Day, Moon Pie. You see the flowers? Moon Pie loves plants, whether they're real or whether they're made of plastic or other synthetic materials. She is all about them. Yeah. Eddie Scarin says, new kitty should be named PewDiePie. Just for memes. Huh. Oh, are you investigating that cycad, Moon Pie? See, this is why I have a plastic cycad. Because the cats love to chew on this, and real cycads are toxic. They are not safe for cats. Huh, not safe. Yeah. Looking at me. Is Minnie Pie trying to sneak up on you too? She loves the plants. Moon Pie's birthday, I'll just set up like a maze of artificial plants for her to run through and chew on and everything else. I think it'd be a good day for you, Moon Pie. I think you'd like that a lot. We'll think about making that happen. Just pretend that it's a surprise, you know? Yeah. Anyway, let's get back to our plants map here. If you'll let me get to my stream deck. Just click it in OBS. There we go.
Through their cells. They love soaking up any water around. Some mosses can absorb 20 times their weight in water. They also tend to be small, typically around 3 to 6 centimeters in height.
Mosses are really amazing plants.
They don't have the rigidity and structure that other plants get from their vascular tissues. The maximum height they can reach is only 60 centimeters tall. Now, every plant we'll meet after this point has got a vascular structure. Based on the fossils we've discovered, they first appeared around 420 million years ago.
See you later.
A vascular plant has specialized tissues called xylem and phloem, which transport water and nutrients throughout its structures. These tissues are rigid and enable vascular plants to grow taller and more complex than the non-vascular plants we've seen so far. Now we get to club mosses and ferns. Club mosses aren't true mosses because they have a vascular structure. But also, club mosses aren't ferns because they've got a different leaf structure to ferns and different DNA. So they're stuck in the middle here on their own. Ferns include whisk ferns, horsetails, and leptosporangiate ferns.
Yeah, so this is actually a really recent development, horsetails being ferns. They were not considered ferns until very recently. I think it was molecular evidence that showed that. And I was talking with Cindy Louie, who's a paleobotanist at the University of California Museum of Paleontology. Or actually, no, I guess she's part of the integrative biology department at UC Berkeley. But anyway, I was talking to her about that, and she's like, yeah, that's a new thing. She's like, I don't know exactly what year it was, but it was like in the last few years, horsetails have been placed within ferns now. They actually, it seems that they share a common ancestor, so they actually group together with ferns. Whereas before, they were thought to be maybe closer to like club mosses, I think. Gooberfish, yeah. Yeah. And Diagnosis is about 20 years now. We do have transitional fossils between horsetails and... Really? Wow. She was saying it was much more recent than that, but I don't know. That's kind of outside of her... Well, no, she studies, like, Devonian plants. Anyway. Yeah, Lenina, how are you doing? Happy National Flower Day to you.
Or leptoferns for short. And these have many of the features we're familiar with from plants. Roots, a vascular structure, and true leaves called fronds. However, they reproduce through spores and not seeds. Ferns are a diverse group with over 10,000 known species inhabiting various habitats worldwide, even underwater. The fossil record for ferns stretches back to 400 million years ago, and the ancestors of today's ferns were giants, towering up to 40 meters in height. The earth was covered in forests of tree ferns. These have mostly died out, but some tree ferns are still with us today. A quick side note, for this map, I can't physically include every plant that exists. So I've chosen a familiar representative for each major group of plants. But from here onwards, I'm going to include the scientific names that classify each group. So if you want to find where your favorite plant sits on this map, just look up its scientific classification and you should be able to place it. From here on, the plants don't use spores to reproduce, but seeds.
There we go.
This was a really important step for the proliferation of plants. A seed is made of a young embryo, some nutritive tissue, and an outer protective covering. First, let's look at the gymnosperms, which today comprise the major groups of cycads, ginkgo, neatum, and conifers like pines and spruces.
Yeah, so these are really, really cool. You don't hear a lot about neatum, at least I don't. But yeah, ginkgos and cycads. I've got a lot of these, you know, plastic ones that I have here in the office. And not as many conifers yet. I need to work on that. But yeah, Krigani Wolfshire says, where did your 3D prints actually go? I mean, they're here. They're just around. I only show off certain ones each day, only ones that are relevant to the day's topic. So, for Thursday Birds Day, we've got our Archaeopteryx. And then for National Flower Day, we've got Erlikosaurus, which is kind of therizinosaur. The rise of the therizinosaurs seems to coincide with the rise of the angiosperms. And it could actually be this group of formerly meat-eating dinosaurs became herbivorous to take advantage of a new source of food, these newfangled flowering plants. So that's why I've got that today. Yeah. Anetum is a tropical vine. It is related to ephedra, a shrub of dry biomes. I've heard of ephedra. Yeah, ephedra, is that Mormon tea? Diagonal? Because we have that in Utah, I think, if I'm thinking of the same thing. Yeah, let's continue.
These first appear in the fossil record cycads. Around 390 million years ago.
Oh, Diagonal, I wish you were here last night for the crossover stream with Belint. We did two different papers on fossil plants. It was a ton of fun. And ephedra in the U.S. is called Mormon tea. Okay, cool, Diagonal. I'm glad I remember that correctly. But yeah, this was one of the papers that we discussed. Disparity of cycad leaves dispels the living fossil metaphor, which I found convincing. I thought it was a really well done paper. It was really cool stuff. So anyway, you can check out the VOD. Anybody who's interested in that, check out the VOD over at Science Streams. Yeah. Hopefully it'll be up on YouTube before too long as well.
To go.
Yeah.
Gymnosperms reproduce through cones, which come in male and female forms.
They're dioecious.
Male cones produce pollen, while female cones contain ovules that develop into seeds upon fertilization. And these are known as naked seeds because they're not covered in anything like a fruit or a hard shell.
Yeah. And it's not going to go into Willamy Pines, Sir Yogi one, because that's a kind of conifer. So they already touched on conifers here.
First, like pines and spruces.
Yeah, so Willamy Pines should be part of that group. Yeah.
Seeds upon fertilization. And these are known as naked seeds because they're not covered in anything like a fruit or a hard shell. Gymnosperms have well-developed vascular tissues, enabling them to grow tall and thrive in various environments. For example, conifers are adapted to cold and dry conditions with needle-like leaves to reduce water loss and sturdy cones for seed protection. I just want to make a little side note on fungi, which naively seem like they're quite like plants.
Oh, they're not. They're closer to animals.
Very different. They don't photosynthesize and are genetically closer to animals than plants.
Bingo.
But they're very important to this map because most plants live in a symbiotic relationship with fungi called mycorrhiza. In this relationship, the plant makes organic molecules by photosynthesis and gives them to the fungus in the form of sugars and lipids, while the fungus supplies the plant with water and minerals like phosphorus from the soil. Also, when plants die, fungi break them down and return the nutrients to the soil. Also, lichens, they're not plants either. They're a partnership between algae and fungi.
Yeah, they're a joint venture. Lichens are a joint venture. They are, Every time I think of lichens, I think of this. Yeah. So anyway, to lay the groundwork for this, Homer was at the dump and then he finds this weird box with like Japanese writing on it, and it has what looks like a picture of his head on it. And he's like, what in the world is this? So he calls up the company in Japan and then they send him a videotape. Oh, and there's so many subtitles here. And I have to have it reversed so I don't get sniped for this on YouTube. But he says, I'm disrespectful to dirt. Can't you see that I am serious? Get out of my way, all of you. This is no place for loafers. Join me or die. Can you do any less? Oh, what a brave corporate logo. I accept the challenge of Mr. Sparkle. Any plans for summer? For lucky best wash, use Mr. Sparkle. Here we go. Ha ha. with their powers combined. Yeah. So, a joint venture. Lichens. Lichens are also a joint venture. There's a point to this, I promise. These guys, you see them on rocks, you see them on trees, you even see them occasionally on fossils in the collections of natural history museums. They can be incredibly tough, and removing them from the surface of a fossil will actually damage the fossil. So sometimes you just leave them on there and you just cover them with Vinac or whatever. Yeah, I remember there's like an Oreodont skull in the collections at UCMP in Berkeley. It's got lichens on it because it was there exposed on the surface and then lichens grew on it over the course of several years. And they're just there forever now. So lichens are really, really cool. And lichens, like he said in the video, are a joint venture between plants and fungi.
And return the nutrients to the
fungi
soil.
And algae.
Also, lichens, they're not plants either. They're a partnership between algae and fungi.
Yep.
But I'm getting sidetracked now. I should probably do a map of fungi as well.
He's getting sidetracked.
Anyway, because
Look
of the close
us.
Relationship between fungi and plants, I've drawn a mycorrhizal network as the background, as it seemed fitting. That's from now on, we'll be looking at the angiosperms, or flowering plants, which first appeared around 135 million years ago.
Yes! In the early, early Cretaceous. Flowering plants. And that brings us to, well, here, let's continue this for a minute, then we'll get into another video.
They're now the most diverse and dominant group of land plants. Nine-tenths of the world's plants have flowers, and over 300,000 species of angiosperms are estimated to live on Earth today.
Pretty impressive.
Around 90% of flowers are adapted to be pollinated by animals, who have also adapted to feed on the nectar or fruit in a symbiotic relationship.
Yep.
Pollen is the male reproductive cell, so basically plant sperm, and the female reproductive cell is called an egg. Mm-hmm. When they meet, they make an embryo, which develops into a seed in the plant ovary. The ovary then develops into a fruit, which encloses the seed. This was a very successful evolutionary feature to both help protect seeds, but also to disperse them when animals ate the fruits and pooed them out. Although this is just one method, there are many other dispersal tactics on the outside of seeds, like hairs or wings to be carried by the wind, or hooks to grab hold of animals.
It's really, really fascinating the different adaptations that plants have evolved in order to actually, you know, help the next generation establish themselves. And, with that said, let's get into this.
The Cretaceous period was an important time for life on Earth. The age of reptiles was in full swing, and dinosaurs were more diverse, more fierce, and more strange than ever. But something else was happening under the feet of the terrible lizards. For the first time in history, there were flowers.
Yeah. Happy National Flower Day, everyone.
The fossil record of flowering plants goes back a long way, about 125 million years, which is what I like to call a very long time. But in the big picture of evolution, flowers are relatively late bloomers. Plants themselves make up a huge branch of the tree of life, including everything from moss you find on rocks to the towering redwoods. But the thing is, before the Cretaceous, Earth's landscape looked very different. If you could go back about 150 million years past the Cretaceous to the Jurassic period, you'd see plants that probably looked familiar, but still the picture would seem a little incomplete. You'd find things like ferns, low-growing, water-loving plants that are still around today. You can probably find one at your nearest doctor's waiting room. And there were lots of conifers, evergreen plants that typically bear cones, like today's pines, firs, and spruces. And then there were the cycads, seed-bearing plants with tough, spiky trunks and green fronds on top. If you wanted to landscape your own Jurassic Park, these are the plants you would need. And what allowed ferns, guys, conifers, cycads, and cycads to conquer the land was the way they reproduced. Ferns, for example, reproduce from spores and need damp environments for their reproductive cells to reach each other. Cycads have have cones with seeds that are directly fertilized by pollen. And for conifers, much of the hard work of fertilization is done by the wind, which carries pollen from the male cones to the female cones. But after the Jurassic gave way to the early days of the Cretaceous, a new form of plant emerged. About 125 million years ago, in a little pond in what's now northeastern China, one of the first flowers bloomed. Paleontologists have called the fossil of this primordial plant Archaefructus leoniensis. It wasn't exactly the type of flower you'd bring home to your significant other. It looks like a pair of little wisps with tiny leaves on the sides.
Like Ben is Italian.
But to paleobotanists, Archaefructus is incredibly exciting because it's one of the first known examples of an angiosperm. What biology?
And SV Harkin, are you leaving? You said aloha. Because you know, aloha can mean hello or goodbye. You'll have to be more specific. Welcome, SV Harkin. It's good to see you.
I just call flower.
Happy National Flower Day.
You see a piece of fruit on a tree.
And yeah, so angiosperms.
Examples of an angiosperm.
Are what we're talking about right now. Flowering plants, which first evolved during the time of the dinosaurs. There's an idea that we'll get to in a little bit that dinosaurs may have, as Bob Bakker put it, invented flowers. Diagonal, I'd love to get your take on this. I haven't asked you about it before. Normally, I don't know, it's fun to think about animals shaping their environments and changing things, but more often than it's the plants that are kind of shaping things for the animals. You know, plants have got a lot of power. In Bakker's 1986 book, The Dinosaur Heresies, he introduces this idea that the rise of flowering plants may have been due to the herbivorous habits of certain dinosaurs. Where is that chapter? Here we go. He calls the chapter When Dinosaurs Invented Flowers. And the idea is basically that new kinds of herbivorous dinosaurs evolved that were very, very heavy grazers, and slower growing plants like ferns, conifers, cycads, were basically just eaten out of house and home by those dinosaurs. And angiosperms, which were kind of quicker to re-recruit, quicker to produce offspring, quicker to grow, that they were able to take over during this like over-browsing regime of these marauding herbivorous dinosaurs like this. It's an interesting idea, and I'd love to get the opinion of an actual botanist on this, you know? But yeah, and horsetails are very fast-growing salamander. They are. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. And thug shells, holy cow! It is an honor. Welcome, Thug Shells and Raiders. How are you doing? Holy moly.
Thug Shells has arrived in force with their army of 129 chickens.
Thank you, Thug Shells, for the raid, and welcome to Paleontologizing. Happy National Flower Day to you. You've caught me on kind of an unusual day here. But, it's great to have you here. Welcome. Thug Shells, first of all, how did your stream go? How was the music? I'm sure it was stellar, as usual. It's great to see you. I'm honored. You know, Lordy, whom I live with here, she listens to you all the time. Even if she's not typing in the chat, she's got you on all the time. So that's some pretty high praise, I think. Anyway, everybody, if I could introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduzzo. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. You probably know already that a paleontologist is a fossil scientist. I work on dinosaur fossils in particular. Dinosaurs are what I study, what I publish on in the scientific literature, what I talk about 5 days a week here on Twitch. usually 5 days a week. Tomorrow is a rare day off. And dinosaurs are what I dig up during the summers. Really, really excited to be leaving again for fieldwork in just a couple of months.
Hadrosaurs, yeah.
Pretty exciting. Well, not proper hadrosaur form.
Gotcha, yeah.
But they really replace our real primitive fillers.
So, yeah, we're going to be
quite see the tops of the shade
doing more dinosaur
there,
digs this summer in Utah and Wyoming.
In that direction or less.
I keep saying they need to have a solar or a satellite link hooked to his hat.
Yeah, that would be nice. Yeah.
You got you covered. The future.
Yeah.
So there's Jim Kirkland. He's the state paleontologist of Utah.
I imagine the mammals would still be
see Therion
like this, living in the nooks and crannies of their world, and we wouldn't be here.
It's great to have you here, C. Therion. Thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. Soylent Green 420 says, how do you feel about the depictions of dinosaurs without feathers? The ones that should have feathers that don't have feathers, I'm disappointed in those, obviously. But yeah. And Carrie Ann Care Bear, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Yeah, shoot, if we're talking about depictions of dinosaurs like Velociraptor and they're shown without feathers, we've known for like 20 years at this point that these animals had feathers. Jurassic World lied to you. Velociraptor did not look like this. It looked like this. Think of it as like a giant ground-running scary eagle. Or a hawk, or something like that. Or almost like a tinamou, but just larger, with teeth, with claws on its hands, long bony tail. And, Sculpin, thank you for those 10 gift subs. Holy cow. Look how excited this tinamou bird is for that. A little too excited. Uh-oh. Oh, shoot.
Sculpin01 is overloading the system with 10 gift subs.
Thank you, Sculpin. I appreciate that. Holy moly.
Do you think dinosaurs are put together correctly? The bones. You're smart. What do you think?
Research on that, Oliver.
I never.
Thanks for the follow, Soylent Green. Here, since we've got a bunch of cool new people here, including you, Soylent Green, and Carrie Ann Care Bear, Colleen Grateful, C. Therion, and of course, the wonderful Thug Shells. Holy cow, if you like music, if you would like to follow a very, very talented DJ here on Twitch, do yourself a favor and go follow Thug Shells right now. Do not hesitate. CTK ACSSR, thank you for the follow. Thug Shells, you're going to be in my neck of the woods this weekend, aren't you? I heard a rumor that you might be here in the San Francisco Bay Area. Is this true? I've got some friends who are really excited to go see you. But yeah, I live here in the San Francisco Bay Area. My house is just over there. Yeah. Anyway, I was lucky enough to meet Thug Shells in person at TwitchCon this year in Las Vegas, last year, back in October, and to go to one of her shows afterward for like the after party, and that was pretty awesome. So Thug Shells, I'm honored that you rated in, and thank you for being who you are. A little bit of background on who I am. I think, since we've got a bunch of cool people here, we might as well call forth our good friend previously recorded Danny to tell you a little bit about why in the world a paleontologist is here on Twitch and kind of what this whole thing is all about. So he's sneaking up behind me right now. We'll turn things over to him briefly here, and don't worry, you're in good hands. Previously recorded Danny, take it away.
Well, thanks, present day Danny.
Well, if you happen to be new around here, then welcome to paleontologizing. You
you may well be wondering to yourself, well, if this is Twitch, then where are the video games? I'm gonna level with you here. I don't really do much in the way of video games. I'm a paleontologist. My name is Danny Anduza, and dinosaurs are my area of study. But how in the world does a paleontologist end up on Twitch? Well, you're about to find out.
When I finished high school, I moved to Montana and immediately started work at Museum of the Rockies, which at the time was an unparalleled powerhouse of paleobiology. That program was built by this guy.
Famed paleontologist Alan Grant.
Well, kind of.
You consulted on that movie.
I did consult on all those movies.
And they said the guy Alan Grant was you.
Yes. Yeah, well, fortunately, he didn't get eaten.
Meet Jack Horner, the real-life Alan Grant. He's one of the most prominent and controversial paleontologists in the country, a dyslexic MacArthur Foundation genius who never finished college and who says he doesn't care why dinosaurs went extinct. To him, the important part is how they lived.
It was at Museum of the Rockies, under the auspices of Jack Horner, that I learned how to be a dinosaur paleontologist. And a huge part of that I learned by working with Jack's final graduate student, a guy by the name of Denver Fowler, who would later go on to become curator of the Badlands Dinosaur Museum. Working with Denver, I did summer after summer of fieldwork in the remote Badlands of Montana. Together, we dug up more dinosaurs than we knew what to do with, at fossil sites numbering in the hundreds. In 2012, I discovered a new species of ceratopsian dinosaur, hopefully soon to be published. The next year, we excavated the world's smallest and youngest Tyrannosaurus rex. Then, we dug up a brand new ankylosaur.
Montana's news leader.
Five paleontologists are excavating what looks to likely be new species of armored dinosaur.
So we found its head, and we found parts of its armor and plates, and so it should be a new species.
Not bad, right? Well, anyway, much like my fieldwork, my research also focuses on dinosaurs.
For example, here's Trirarchuncus, the last of the alvarosaurs, just published in July of 2020.
One of my current projects focuses on spinosaurids. Really talk too much about that until it's a little bit closer to publication, so stay tuned for that.
Anyway, let's get back to how I ended up on Twitch. A couple years ago, things in Montana were declining rapidly, so I picked up and moved on to greener pastures. I'm so glad I did.
And with that new perspective, I also realized that I have very little patience for the soul-crushing bureaucracy within academia. For the time being, anyway, I decided to take my career in a slightly different direction.
I got hired for a job in early childhood education. As a teacher, I get to have a positive impact on kids' lives, help them find a passion for science. Then, when COVID-19 showed up, the school had to close. But that didn't stop the teaching or the learning. We just moved online.
All right, friends. So, we're going to be looking at a book in a little bit, but I thought we'd start off with a song. At three, two, one.
Oh, give me a home
where the hadrosaurs roamed, where triceratops bellowed and grazed, where erosion uncovers bones we seek to discover, for to strike the whole world amazed. Home on the range,
where the deer and the antelope play,
where seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the skies are not cloudy all day.
It was a pretty easy jump from teaching online to streaming on Twitch. I had my first broadcast in May, I've been on here ever since. Now, I believe pretty strongly that any good scientist should also be a public servant. In my opinion, talking to everyday people about her science is one of the most important things that a researcher can do. I now have a golden opportunity to reach out directly to people where they are.
This is what I'm all about, and now, thanks to Twitch, I get to share it with you. And I'm so happy to be able to do so.
It's my intention to continue this mission of education by answering your questions, providing good science content, and working to grow this channel. And if you could help by following, or if you could afford it, by subscribing, I would be deeply grateful.
So anyway, to my regular viewers, thank you again for sitting through this. To everybody who's new, welcome. I'm genuinely, earnestly glad that you're here. I hope you stick around. We've got a remarkable little community here, and be delighted if you join us. Anyway, let's go ahead and get back into it. So, present day Danny, back to you.
Well, thank you very much, previously recorded Danny. And of course, thank you even more to Thug Shells for that incredible raid. I really appreciate it. For all the new folks, I hope that answers some questions. And I'm actually in the process of creating some new welcome videos because that one is, the ones that I have are a little bit out of date. I've done a bunch of cool stuff since then. I've gone full-time here on Twitch. This is a dream come true to be able to do science outreach and make my living at it. It's such a privilege. We did a bunch of fieldwork live streams last summer, and I'm looking forward to doing even more this next summer.
All right, let's see if that did it. Let me know if you can see or hear me, everybody. Oh, hello, everybody, and welcome back to Paleontologizing. It's really good to have you here. A little bit late today, but that's because we're setting up a special stream. This is our second to last day digging in the quarry. So Jim thought we should talk a little bit about the local geology here.
Likewise, Belen.
And so we're both excited to take you on a little tour through the earliest Cretaceous here in eastern Utah, and should be a lot of fun.
I'm going to be starting at the end of May at the latest this year.
Utah State paleontologist Jim Kirkland over here. And I'm Danny Anduza, paleontologist from California. And we've been out here for almost 3 weeks now. Actually, no, it is. Today's day 22. So, before we head back to civilization in a couple days, figured this would be a great opportunity to take a look at some of these strata. There's Jim there.
Oh, certainly. And we got a little bit hazier than we would like.
Yeah, but at least it's not as hot as it normally is this time of day, so that's a plus. We got some wildfire smoke or something.
Yeah, there's some fires over Beaver, but bit 150 miles due west.
Gotcha. That's why it smells so smoky.
Yeah, the smoke's blowing in here.
Yeah.
But we've had a pretty clear year, so can't complain.
We've been lucky so far. This is the first real smoke we've gotten.
Anyway. Basically going all the way around this area.
This is a cool,
a couple little outlets,
a cool day. So Jim Kirkland's the official state paleontologist for the entire state of Utah. I've done a lot of work with him in the field
for
the last couple years.
Information bonanza in terms of the history of paleoclimate across the Jurassic Cretaceous boundary. If we look up at this outcrop right behind us, that big bluff, that sandstone bench on top, is the Poison Strip member of the Cedar Mountain Formation. And the rocks under it, all the way to near the base, it's a little fuzzy, but you might be able to make out some red sandstone in there and some muds. That's the base of the Yellow Cat. It's a gravelly river system in this area. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's a paleosol. Where it's a meter plus.
Discussing some of the rocks up close.
But when you look at this, you got all these cherts and all the roots, root all through here.
Fossil roots.
Roots of these ferns.
And Ms. Zala, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. And hello, Geoloxo. What's shaking? And Alexander Morrison. Yes, indeed, Jim Kirkland.
Coming out.
Can't wait to be digging with him again.
Something similar to the Tempskia that we've been
in July this year.
Certainly. And what we see in the quarry are little rounded chunks of root.
Yeah.
That have been already partly silicified, broken up, and then reworked into the site.
Huh.
So this stuff's forming right near the surface.
Right.
And the silica is coming from volcanic ash down in the Jurassic. And work is seeping its way up. Huh. Yes. Pretty dry out here, no doubt. But this is a pretty neat little outcrop because, you know, you look here, there's just pieces of root all over.
Uh-huh.
But then you see the...
These are fossil roots.
Dirt beds.
Close to 140 million years old.
Just roots everywhere.
Uh-huh.
Roots.
This is just before the first flowering plants evolve, which is kind of our subject of today's stream. But, yeah, Hulary Schmulary says cassowary birds are definitely a dinosaur. Not just cassowaries, all birds, Hulary Schmulary. And we'll be getting into that in just a little bit. In fact, we'll be getting into that very shortly. Starting our Thursday Birds Day festivities, I have got to continue with our video here. Let's close this out talking about the origin of flowers. Yeah.
First time in history there were flowers.
Yeah.
The fossil record of flowering plants goes back a long way, about
125
million years, which is what I like to call a very long time. But in the big picture of evolution, flowers are relatively late bloomers. Plants themselves make up a huge branch of the tree of life, including everything from moss you find on rocks to the towering redwoods. But the thing is, before the Cretaceous, Earth's landscape looked very different. If you could go back about 150 million years past the Cretaceous to the Jurassic period, you'd see plants that probably looked familiar, but still the picture would seem a little incomplete. You'd find things like ferns.
So yeah, here, where's that image? There we go, yeah. This is a lovely John Sibbick illustration. John Sibbick's a well-known paleo artist from the UK. This is supposed to be like a Jurassic or early Cretaceous floodplain before the evolution of flowers. You've got cycads, you've got ferns and horsetails, conifer trees. These look like Araucaria. Kind of like monkey puzzle trees in the background there. You got tree ferns, club mosses, and spike mosses, and no flowers and no grasses. Grass did not evolve. There were no grasses when dinosaurs were walking around. Grass is a new phenomenon, basically, just in the last 50 million years or so. Dinosaurs would not have encountered fields of grass as we're used to thinking of them.
Ferns, low-growing, water-loving plants that are still around today. You can probably find one at your nearest doctor's waiting room. And there were lots of conifers, evergreen plants that typically bear cones, like today's pines, firs, and spruces.
Yeah. See, Therian's got a question about carnivorous plants and why they evolved. Usually carnivorous plants are found in very, very poor quality soils. So if a plant can't get its nutrients from the soil, it can try and get nitrogen, and other nutrients like that from animals instead, from insects or occasionally from even vertebrates on occasion, things like pitcher plants. But yeah.
And then there were the cycads, seed-bearing plants with tough, spiky trunks and green fronds on top. If you wanted to landscape your own Jurassic Park, these are the plants you would need. And what allowed...
Gary Ankelis's dinosaur homeowner associations were different. No lawns. Or at least the lawns would not have been made of grasses. They would have been made of things like horsetails. Yeah. Stuff like this. Yeah. Or club mosses. Yeah, things like this. You know, bryophyte plants, I think. Or lycopod plants. Club mosses and spike mosses. Stuff like that. No grasses, though. They hadn't evolved yet.
Allowed ferns, conifers, and cycads to conquer the land was the way they reproduced. Ferns, for example, reproduce from spores and need damp environments for their reproductive cells to reach each other. Cycads have cones with seeds that are directly fertilized
like
by
them?
Pollen.
And
for
know.
Conifers,
so, like,
much
question.
Of the hard work of fertilization is done by
probably
the
not
wind,
too different from
which
today.
Carries pollen from the male cones to the female cones. But after the Jurassic gave way to the early days of the Cretaceous, a new form of plant emerged. About 125 million years ago, in a little pond in what's now northeastern China, one of the first flowers bloomed. Paleontologists have called the fossil of this primordial plant Archae Fructus Leoniensis. It wasn't...
That means the ancient fruit of Leoni.
...have called the fossil of this primordial plant Archae Fructus Leoniensis.
So yeah, that means... Archaeo means ancient. Fructus means fruit, presumably. Leoniensis means from Liaoning. Liaoning province in eastern China.
It wasn't exactly the type of flower you'd bring home to your significant other. It looks like a pair of little wisps with tiny leaves on the sides. But to paleobotanists, Archaea fructus is incredibly exciting because it's one of the first known examples of an angiosperm.
Yeah, Gary Ankalasis, they use the word arch like an archosaur. That's actually a different word. So arch and archosaur means like... it's associated with like ruling, where it's like a... This is like the dominant group of animals, the rulers of the time. That's what archosaur means, is ruling reptiles. Archosaurs are the group that include crocodiles, dinosaurs, and birds. If we go back to our tree of life here, away from the angiosperms, the flowering plants, and to archosauria today, since this tree only includes living creatures today, doesn't include many extinct critters, on this tree, archosaurs is just going to be birds and crocodilians. Archosauria. The name means ruling reptile. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, angiosperms are the flowering plants, and that's the subject of today's stream. Yeah.
What biologists call flowering plant. If you see a piece of fruit on a tree or a flower in a garden, you're looking at an angiosperm.
No.
Also known as fruiting plants, angiosperms place their seeds inside an enclosure. And that is, evolutionarily speaking, a big deal. Because those enclosed seeds couldn't just be pollinated by the wind or the water. Instead, for the first time, in order to reproduce, plants had to enlist the help of animals. The main task of the flower, for example, is to attract pollinators, so they can help
We do a lot of mixing
work of fertilization.
Yes,
and the fruit that grows around the fertilized seeds is basically just a tasty capsule that encourages animals to eat the seeds and then drop them elsewhere. So basically, angiosperms evolved to hijack animals' attraction to what's fragrant and what's tasty. And you can see those beginnings in little Archaea fructus, whose anatomy had a lot in common with modern flowers. For example, Archaea fructus had modified leaves that surrounded its egg cells, forming what's called a carpel, and it had pollen-producing organs called stamens. These features are seen in flowering plants today, but instead of being wrapped up in pretty petals like flowers that we know, these reproductive parts were arranged along the stem of the plant. Nonetheless, Archaea fructus and others like it marked a turning point in the evolutionary history of plants. Once that started, neither plants nor animals would ever be the same.
Yep. It was a huge deal.
Angiosperms spurred the evolution of many different pollinators, some of which unknowingly became adapted to help plants reproduce. And in time, flowering plants took over the world. By the time of Triceratops and T-Rex in the late Cretaceous, angiosperms were becoming more plentiful, replacing the cycads and conifers that had grown there before. Eventually, they took on more familiar forms as the world saw its first forest of magnolias, oaks, and beech trees. Today,
magnolias are some of the first of the flowering plants to evolve. And that's why I've got magnolias here in the office today. And also some rhododendra, which I mistakenly bought thinking that they existed during the Mesozoic. Apparently they're like Eocene in origin or something. Or maybe Paleocene. I don't think we have fossil rhododendrons from the Mesozoic yet, but we do have magnolias. Oh yeah, magnolias like this right here too.
Replacing the cycads and conifers that had grown there before. Eventually, they took on more familiar forms as the world saw its first forest of magnolias, oaks, and beech trees.
I like
today,
that idea, Alexander
Morrison. Today, the biggest single group in the plant kingdom, accounting for more than 80% of the world's terrestrial plant. It may seem strange to think of something as fragile as Archaea fructus as starting a global revolution, but that's exactly what the angiosperms did. And to think, it all started
Lord
with
Zeth,
a little wisp of
Welcome
a plant on. That sprouted in the shadows of
Welcome
the dinosaurs.
Yeah, good stuff. Good stuff. Here, I can show you another quick clip. That went faster than I thought it would. Here we go. Those of you who've seen the classic series Walking with Dinosaurs, you might remember this part here. That's Iguanodon right there from the early Cretaceous period. So lots of tree ferns. Yeah. Yep. Yep. They're like pre-digesting their food by chewing it. So, by the late Cretaceous, a bunch of different dinosaurs evolved to do this. Yeah, here we go. Yes! Yeah. Anyway, yeah. There's that. I wish we had more time to talk about this today, but it's also Thursday Birds Day, and we've got to get into that too. So, shoot, we will be talking more about the origin of flowers, I'm sure, at some other point. We've got other, I think, what is it? April 12th is like Plant a Flower Day or something like that. National Flower Day, March 21st. Plant a Flower Day, March 12th. I thought there were other ones. Let's just search Flower Day. March 21st today. Okay. Oh, wait, maybe on Lay Day, which is also May Day, May 1st. Maybe we'll talk about the evolution of flowering plants again. But right now, I've got less than an hour now to get us through Thursday Birds Day. So without further ado, let's get into Thursday Birds Day.
Hold on, something's coming out of here. Look, there's a bird, dude, it knows what's good. I'm telling you, I just heard it inside.
Thursday Birds Day.
Birds are all around us in everyday life. But most of the time we hardly even notice them. Thursday Birds Day is a step toward correcting this oversight. Do you want to be part of Thursday Birds Day?
I don't know.
Here's how you can contribute. Go outside during the week and pay special attention to the birds around you. See if you can take a picture of a bird. It doesn't have to be a good picture, any old photo will do. Upload the picture to the Discord, and we will discuss it on Thursday. Simple as that. Thursday Birds Day is an invitation to go outside and appreciate the grandeur of the natural world. It's a reminder that, since birds are theropods, dinosaurs still enrich our daily lives.
It's great!
And finally, it's a celebration of the amazing history of life on our planet. So, happy Thursday Birds Day!
Happy, happy Thursday Birds Day to you, everybody. And without further ado, since we've got, like, 45 minutes, let's get into it. Holy cow. Let's take a look at some of the bird photos that were submitted by members of this community. Casey Snowart is first here. Says, greetings, friends. May I present to you this fine Birds Day, the Gray Jay, one of my favorite Colorado corvids. It's also known as the Canada Jay, though it can range well down in the Southern Rockies. These high-altitude theropods rarely come down out of the mountains, prefer to live near the tree line. And there's a lot of text here. I appreciate you writing it, Casey. I wish I had more time to read all of it. Lovely. My mom and I were climbing Mount Evans a while back and encountered this individual when it swooped in at my mom's granola bar. After some nervous laughter, we decided to toss a snack into the woods to distract it from us. I held out a peace offering from my fruit and nut bar, and the cheeky fellow snatched it right out of my hand. I admit I was charmed and may have offered a tribute a few times. Holy cow, that is a magical Thursday birthday photo. Casey Snowart, you're setting the bar very, very high right at the beginning. Holy cow. That's fantastic. I've never encountered one of these birds before. A gray jay. Member of the Corvid family. Take a look at that. What a beautiful theropod there. One more time. Oh, that is incredible. Here. One more time. That is phenomenal there. Casey Snowart, holy cow. Is that amazing? Very, very nice. Very, very nice. Thank you for sharing. Here, let's look them up real quick on our Tree of Life also. For those of you who came in with Thug Shells, hopefully you're aware of this concept already, but if you're not, happy to show you really briefly. As far as we know, all life on Earth originated about 3.8 billion years ago. And all stems from a single common ancestor. So all life on Earth is related. And we use what we call the Tree of Life, or a big evolutionary phylogeny, to help illustrate this concept. As evolutionary biologists, paleontologists, zoologists, and botanists, and biologists in general. Let's look up the gray jay here. You can call me gray, or you can call me jay. You can call me gray jay, or you can call me by my scientific name, Parasaurius canadensis. Very cool. Yeah. Mattman says there are lots of gray jays in the Mount Rainier area. Or Mount Rainier, if you're fancy. We call them camp robbers. Nice, Madman. That's cool. Very cool. That's lovely. Oh, this is wonderful, Casey Snowden. This is wonderful. And is this a yellow-rumped warbler? If so, yay, Charcone. I don't know. Could be. I'm not very good at my warbler identification yet. That's really cool, Charcone. Very cool. Let's jump to Yellow Rumped Warbler. There we go. Our Lemon Rumped Warbler? Let's hope that's the same thing. That'll be way over here. Yeah. You know, looks like it. Cool, Charcone. Penguins and a Cape Barren goose or two for my trip to Phillip Island. Dinosaur Dave, very cool. Very, very cool. Oh, this is so neat. There are penguins native to Australia. And I think we're seeing one right there. It's hard to make out, but yeah. Look under the walkway for one of the penguins. Ah, I see it. Yeah, right there under the... Yeah. It's right here. You see it now? Yeah. Very cool.
Look at all those chickens.
And Lord Zath, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you. Yeah. And... See, Therian, yeah, that's still a big mystery. We still don't have any pre-flight fossils of bats. It's still, we don't know what the bat ancestors looked like in particular. But people are working on it. People are working on it for sure. Yeah. Do we know what drove them to evolve flight? We really don't. That's a good question. Yeah, but... I think a lot of that is just that we don't have any really good, like, Lagerstätten fossil deposits between the late Cretaceous and the Eocene. If we had, like, a Paleocene Lagerstätte, you'd probably have those proto-bats in there, I would imagine. I don't know. Bats are a weird group in that they're incredibly speciose. There are so many species of bats nowadays. And they're just... they all evolved from a single species, so finding that single species is going to be very tricky. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. And yes, C-Therian says, I know bats are not birds, but yeah. So bats are mammals. Bats are much closer to us, the Tree of Life, than they are to dinosaurs or birds, obviously. And 1/4 of mammals are bats. Yeah, they're very, very speciose. Very diverse group. Yeah. Anyway, we got to move through these with some alacrity. We've got, in the Ubon Zoo in Thailand, we've got, those look like South African penguins there. I might get to see some of these tomorrow. Oh man, I can't wait. I'm not going to be streaming tomorrow, because I'm going to be hanging out with penguins and other critters, hopefully. I'll take some photos for you, everybody. We've got a... is that a gold-crowned stork? Is that what it's called? That looks almost like a guinea fowl, like a helmeted guinea fowl. We have a cassowary. Cassowarius cassowarius, the great southern cassowary. From Andy's the One. My favorite extant bird. They are so cool. We've got an Indian peafowl. A peacock, indeed. The male. And some kind of cetaciform bird, some kind of parrot. I don't know what kind. Very nice, Danny's the One. Very nice. And a macaw there. Looks like maybe a scarlet macaw or a military macaw. Very cool. And an ostrich, Struthio camelus. Lovely. And you're full of photos today. And a penguin parade. Oh, this is super cool. A group of penguins on the beach? I don't actually see them. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Oh, nice. Nice, nice, nice. That's super cool, Dinosaur Dave. Seeing wild penguins on the beach is something I've never done before, but I would love to someday. Holy moly. And Gamer Mouse is delayed at the drive-thru ATM. Delayed by some Branta canadensis. Canada geese. These are formidable animals. Canada geese. Holy cow. They've got some moxie. They will mess you up. Or at least they act like they'll mess you up. They're like, hey! Or maybe, honk! I'm walking here. gotta love geese. Anytime a bird like that's got that much attitude, just respect, you know? Mayor Space has got a gray catbird. Very nice. Where does that belong on the tree, I wonder? We'll take a look. Seen while hiking with my sister and her kids. Very cool, Mayor Space. Very cool. I'm sure you're a cool uncle, Mayor Space, pointing out different birds. Here, let's jump to gray catbird. There we go. Ooh, far away from our warblers there. Very nice. Cool. So they're related to mockingbirds and thrashers. Very cool. Nice. Nice, nice, nice. Thanks for sharing, Mayor Space. Do bats count as birds? They don't, Andes, but they're still cool. Bats wish they were birds. Let's put it that way. This little female or immature house sparrow, had really had me stumped for a while. It could have been a red crossbill, possibly. But in pictures 1 and 3, it looks like she might be missing the tip of her bottom beak. Interesting. Doesn't look like a house sparrow to me. Here, let's open in browser. Let's zoom in and enhance. Yeah, that doesn't look like a house sparrow to me, unless... It doesn't look like a female house sparrow, no. Could be a crossbill. Interesting. Let's look up crossbills on the Tree of Life, too. Genus Loxia. There we go. Yeah. It's funny, the parrot crossbill looks a lot like an egg. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know enough about these birds, but cool stuff, salamander. Cool stuff. But I scoured Merlin and the Cornell website, and the only thing confirmed in this area that had the white streak on the head was a house sparrow. Usually it's the males that have got that, a female house sparrow. They're much more drab looking. Although, no, you're right. You're right, they do have kind of a streak like that. It's funny, I'm used to thinking of the males as being the only ones with any, like, observable patterning, but no, the females definitely have patterning there. It's just more subtle than the males. It's a female and a male together. It probably is a house sparrow. Yeah. Good work there, salamander. I think that is a female house sparrow. It threw me for a loop. That's cool. Yeah. Rosand, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. And Risa Degas has got an immature cardinal, and something I clipped from a visit to a natural history museum in Atlanta that I thought was really cool that I had never considered with cowbirds. Ooh, northern cardinal. This one's looking kind of drab. I wonder if it's immature. Yeah, you did say immature. Sorry, scatterbrained today. Cowbirds are nest parasites that lay their eggs in the nests of other songbirds. Raised by these foster songbirds, the young cowbirds must forge their musical identities independent of their biological relatives. At 6 days old, a cowbird chick can already recognize fellow cowbirds in the area. By listening closely to these birds' vocalizations, cowbird chicks learn to sing without ever needing to directly interact with another member of their species. That's nuts. That is really interesting, and it speaks to maybe some aspect of their... It's like it's inborn, instinctual a little bit more than learned, maybe. Or maybe it's not, I don't know. But that's really interesting stuff. That's really interesting stuff. Tarquin has got an Andean condor, Vulture gryphus, at my local zoo. His roommate, another condor, hopped up onto the ledge with those big wings flapping. It was amazing. Condors are so cool. We've got some at the Oakland Zoo here in the East Bay Area near San Francisco, and they are my favorite animals to spend time with. When they're right up close, it's amazing. Just that wingspan and the bald head of theirs, and just... There's something really, really cool about them. They remind me of... like Teratornis. Yeah. Here. Charles Knight. There we go. They remind me of the Teratorns that lived alongside saber-toothed cats and stuff. We find their fossils in the La Brea tar pits. They're incredible birds. They really are. Just amazing. Yeah. Condors occupy a similar niche. These guys are just bigger. And they died out at the same time that the big megafauna died out. Mammoths and mastodons and ground sloths and American horses and saber-toothed cats and stuff. These guys made their living scavenging the remains of those animals. So when those animals died out, these guys died out as well. Similar fate for the California condors, where when a lot of other large mammals were erased from the landscape, you don't have a lot of elk and stuff running around anymore in the way that they used to. Now it's cattle. Condors don't have much to eat anymore, so that's one of the reasons for their decline. Yeah, and I've never been up to John Day, no, Cetherian, but I have worked with fossils from John Day at the museum here in Berkeley. But, yeah. Those are all mammal fossils. I'm a dinosaur guy. But I'm sure it would be really cool to visit. And only at a zoo will you see geese and ostriches sharing the same turf. No, there are geese in, well, yeah, maybe not on the Serengeti, but there are definitely geese in Egypt. And we used to have ostriches in Egypt. I don't know if there's any ostriches in Egypt anymore. But that's pretty cool. Struthio camelus and Branta canadensis. Two big, mostly terrestrial birds. Who both have got an attitude. Yeah. Oh, and Egyptian geese can be seen in South Africa. Cool, salamander. Okay. So yeah, geese and ostriches are not strangers to each other in the wild. That's a different kind of goose, not a Canada goose. That's pretty funny. Sometimes I think Canada geese think they're as big as an ostrich. Just the attitude that they have. They are... Oh man, they are wild sometimes. Yeah. The geese allow the ostriches to be there, says Eugen, yes. very cool. And Hyacinth has got a flock of mixed blackbirds, mostly what I think are brown-headed cowbirds, from what I've seen and heard. There are also some bigger birds and a few smaller birds in the flock, which I found so interesting. Sometimes birds form mixed species flocks. It's pretty cool sometimes. Here. I don't know if we're going to get the audio here. Because I usually have this muted, and Chrome is really bad about muting and unmuting sites. But, Aaron, how do I make this bigger? How do I embiggen this? Here we go. Unmute. Sound up. Oh, it didn't work. Oh, it did. It's just kind of quiet. Nice. If you skip towards the end, you could see them fly off. There we go. Nice. It's cool. The kind of nondescript birds like this, the ones that are just brown or black or gray, they often don't get a lot of attention. So Hyacinth, I'm impressed that you chose to photograph them and give them some love here. They deserve it. That's really cool, Hyacinth. That's really cool. Brown-headed cowbirds. Let's take a look at them on the Tree of Life and see how close they are to our crossbills. Brown-headed cowbird. All right, let's just search cowbird. Cowbirds. Over there. There we go. Nice. Very nice. This is cool. Yeah. Yeah, cool stuff. They're my morning friends. They hang out in my front tree each morning. They keep the squirrels away. Good for them. Very cool. Yeah. Cowbirds, like the brown-headed cowbird. That is exactly what I typed in. Why didn't it recognize them? Brown-headed cowbird right there. Molothrus ater. What a cool genus name. Molothrus. Look upon my works, ye mighty, in despair, for I am Molothrus. Look upon mine plumage and mine brown head. I love it. Cowbirds. Yeah. And the screaming cowbird. That sounds like a band name. you know? Again, I've made this joke before, but it's like, oh, hello, Fresno! We are the Screaming Cowbirds! Yeah. What does that sound like, Pimpcat? Let's look it up. What does a screaming cowbird sound like? I'm sure it sounds positively angelic. Screaming cowbird flock. Let's see what they sound like here. Wow. Incredible. My goodness. Oh, wait, no, shoot, it's muted. Let's try again. It's kind of squeaky. They're less screamy than I was anticipating. Huh. Try screaming cowbird call. I don't know if we'll find a screaming cowbird, but let's try a brown-headed cowbird song. It sounds like a red-winged blackbird. I wonder if they're related. Let's look up red-winged blackbird here and see how close they are to... Red-winged blackbird. They're right there. There we go. That makes perfect sense. They're really close to each other. But I also spied in our search results here another bird, a white bellbird. Listen to the world's loudest bird call. You may want to move your headphones away from your ears. What? It's not that loud. What? Oh, never mind. Oh, shoot. Okay. Fair. That is a white bellbird. That's a cool critter. Holy moly. Yeah. Anyway, Hyacinth, thank you for driving us onto this tangent. That was fun. Good stuff. Majestic Biscuits got a red robin. A robin I had seen while delivering on my mail route. Very cool, Majestic Biscuit. Turdus migratorius is the American robin. American robins are actually a kind of thrush. They are not related to European robins. This is why we use scientific names, people, is because when we say robin, a robin is a completely different bird depending on where you live in the world. American robin. Turdus migratorius. And Batman's robin isn't a bird at all. It's true, Cephaline. It's true. American robin. Turdus migratorius. And then let's go to European robin. Oh, and American robins, by the way, are a kind of thrush. It's a wide-eyed thrush. Or the Kakura chain thrush or the Komoro thrush. They're thrushes. As opposed to the European robin, which is going to be way far away. Over there. Yeah. Erythacus rubicula. They're related to chats and short wings. Huh. Cool. Yeah. To chat us? Yeah, he's related to you, the Star King. Boulder chat from Colorado, I presume. And, but wait, there's another group of thrushes? Again, this is why we use scientific names. Yeah, chats and old world flycatchers. Anyway, cool stuff. Right here. Very nice, Majestic Biscuit. So that's a true Thursday Bird's Day bird. You just spotted it while you're outside doing your thing, and you took a photo. This is what we love for Thursday Bird's Day. Doesn't take a great deal. It doesn't take a super excellent camera. It doesn't take anything like that. Just go out there and photograph a bird, you know? It counts. Yeah. And another great bluey. Like the cartoon dog, right? This vid took longer than expected to edit properly. Credit to Brian Eng for his awesome music. Let's make sure we're unmuted here. And Smolin and... Ooh, great blue heron. Oh, that is fantastic. These are wonderful birds. All I can say, what a great angle too. Alexander Morrison, this is brilliant. Yeah. All I can say is that we as human beings are very lucky that these birds are not even twice as big, they would probably pose a danger to us. Imagine if this bird were like four times as big, it would be eating people left and right, you know? Just impaling us with that beak. They'll eat just about any other critter too, like anything that's small enough to fit down their gullet, from big fishes to small alligators. Frogs and other birds and mollusks and invertebrates and just all kinds of critters. Herons have got a special place in my heart. Because I'm kind of working on them a little bit. I had to learn a lot about herons for an upcoming scientific paper, which I'm looking forward to telling you more about when the time is right. Lordy! Has got a different kind of heron for us. Well, 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 Lordy. This is a black-crowned night heron. And was this on the banks of Lake Merritt, Lordy? Oh, this is lovely. This is our municipal bird, or it's the municipal bird for the city of Oakland, I should say. They've got this lovely, vibrant red eye like that. This black crown on the top of their head. They've got these long white plumes. It's crazy, like, the way that they retract their neck. So sometimes it looks like they don't have a neck at all. And then they stretch their neck out, and it's, like, twice as long as their body. It's really nuts. The black-crowned night heron. Yeah... Here, take a look at this right here.
New at 10, Oakland's official city bird is in danger. So this week, the Oakland Zoo and Audubon Society are relaunching a rescue program to save the wild birds nesting along the streets of Oakland. KTV's Gianna Katsuyama joins us live now to explain.
And Christina, many people might not even realize that Oakland has an official city bird, let alone be able to name it if they saw it up in the trees. But right now is its nesting season, and that brings it into a very difficult and dangerous time for the baby birds that are beginning to hatch.
There's Lake Merritt. Springtime, I think this is where Lordy photographed her bird.
Birds of a certain feather together.
People think of city birds, they think of, you know, pigeons, and maybe these days we think of crows.
But look closely in the trees downtown and listen. And you might find yourself facing the city of Oakland's official bird.
We have these amazing black-crowned night herons that have nested in Oakland for hundreds of years.
But Glenn Phillips, executive director of the Golden Gate Audubon Society, says the black-crowned night heron needs help. So they're partnering with the Oakland Zoo on a rescue mission.
These are feathered dinosaurs.
Phillips says problem is that the herons have moved over the years from Lake Merritt to colonies downtown at 12th and Harrison, as well as over at Oak and 10th.
This is a wildlife problem that's happening right here in Oakland, right in our own backyard.
Colleen Kinsley, vice president of animal care and conservation at the Oakland Zoo, says when the baby herons hatch, they aren't able to fly, so they often fall from the trees onto the pavement.
They can get hit by cars, attacked by dogs, and the parents oftentimes won't continue to feed them because it's too dangerous even for the parents to come down to the ground.
This week, the zoo relaunched their heron rescue teams for the first time since the pandemic shut down the program.
We were able to hire 4 part-time employees to be our heron rescue team.
The rescue teams go on patrol, searching
the
hired
people too
for any hatchlings.
We're just
doesn't have to be a volunteer thing.
A little bit of extra help of, you know, getting some food, getting some warmth, getting some protection until they're maybe 2, 3, 4 weeks older and can live on their own.
The rescue program was launched
Heron
after
Karen.
A tree in Oakland fell in 2019, endangering a colony of herons and snowy egrets nesting in its branches. Since then, the Oakland Zoo has taken the rescued baby herons to the International Bird Rescue in Fairfield, where they're fed until they're strong enough to be released back into the wild.
They're not an endangered species, but they're a species of concern because they're really important indicators of the health of our environment.
And there are the city bird in Oakland.
And the Oakland Zoo is distributing flyers and postcards with a special rescue hotline for people to call if you see a baby bird on the ground. And back here live, they tell me that they have funding enough for 3 years to continue this program, but they are certainly looking for support. They hope to continue protecting these herons well
this
into the future.
One year ago.
Let's hope they get that support too. Gianna Katsuyama live in Oakland. Gianna, thank you.
Cool stuff. Yeah. That's the black-crowned night heron, which Lordy spotted. And Lordy doesn't often post Thursday Birds Day birds, so this is really cool. And I also see Branta canadensis, again, our Canada goose, and some kind of gull up there, too. I'm not sure what kind of gull. Yeah. Yeah. Neat. Good at Mega Man says, I saw what appears to be a common grackle down on the Toronto waterfront on Tuesday. And even common birds like common grackles still have an incredible kind of beauty about them if you look closely. Look at that iridescence along the feathers there. Just beautiful. And I love, sometimes when you photograph a bird, sometimes when you go out bird watching, the birds watch you right back. It's pretty neat how that works, you know? That kind of iridescence that you're seeing right there too, that is a hint of what this bird would actually look like to another bird. So when we see that iridescence, that kind of like shiny bluish purplish, like, ooh, what's going on there? That's even more vibrant to birds because birds can actually see partway into the ultraviolet spectrum. Yeah, they can see UV light. Exactly, Psychanalysis, yeah. So birds have tetrachromatic vision. They can see more colors than we can. And when we see a sparkle of iridescence in there, that's just like a tantalizing hint of the full color spectrum that birds can see. It's really, really neat. Dinosaurs would have been the same way. Mesozoic dinosaurs, whom birds inherited their eyes from, they would have had tetrachromatic vision as well. Would have been able to see more colors than we can. Colors we can't even imagine, given that we can't see them. We have trichromatic vision. They have tetrachromatic vision. And also, why flowers have UV pigments. Exactly, Psychnalis, exactly. Yeah. And Alexander Morrison says, looks almost like a boat-tailed grackle by that the tail ship. Maybe, I don't know. Yeah. Very cool, Jedi Mega Man, very cool. And Victarius says, in honor of spring, a juvenile robin I photographed last year. And this is lovely, beautiful photo. My goodness. That is gorgeous right there. Very, very nice. Yeah. Very nice, Victarius. I love seeing just those little, like, eyelash and chin feathers that they have. That's, oh man, it's very cool. It's neat when birds have whiskers, you know? They're not hairs, they're feathers. Totally different developmental pathway and everything. Different homology, but it's a different structure, but it's convergent. It's two different creatures, birds and mammals, both developing sensory filaments that come off their faces like that. It's lovely. And it's a great photo, isn't it, Saggy Iguana? That mocha effect? Gorgeous. Gorgeous. Yeah. And Thing says, these are my sister's society finches. Ooh. Hi, society finches. Who are named Twitch and Jolt after old spells from Magic the Gathering. They are a gay couple. They look quite happy. Thing, this is beautiful. I like that a lot. Society finches. Let's jump from European Robin to Society Finch. Let's just try Finch. Finches, Finches. Finches and More. What's a store I'd like to visit? Finches and More. Finches and More for all your Finch needs. Visit Finches and More. Very nice. Pretentious passerine birds, Alexander Morrison. Are they passerine birds? They probably are. They're perching birds, yeah. Very cool. Anyway, good stuff, then. Good stuff. Thanks for posting. Lovely. Rachel Darling Endeavor says, I would need to run some errands and stop by Finches and More. Anyone want a carpool? Yeah. Can we stop by Beverages, Bovines, and Beyond? Axeman has got a mourning dove. A mourning dove that came to my theater. It's probably the most timid bird I have ever had visited. Let me take one quick shot of it, evaluating how dangerous I was, before it flew off to a nearby tree and checked behind to make sure I wasn't following. X-Man, these really are just some of the most demure birds. Their personality really kind of reminds me of Sweetie Pie, the cat here, one of my feline overlords. They just have similar vibes, you know? Yeah, they look so soft and delicate. I know, right, Salamander? Yeah. That's lovely photos, Axeman. Even if you had to scare a dove to get them, I think it was worth it. Doesn't take much to scare a dove. Look at that. It's beautiful. Beautiful animals. And Sir Yogi One has got Galas, lorikeets, and a butcher bird in my yard right now. The lorikeet land on us and eat from our hands. They eat your hand. Oh, they eat from your hands. Oh. Good. I know animals get wild down there in Straya. glad they're just eating from your hands. I have one that was cuddling into my face a couple days ago. That is pretty awesome. That's got to be a rainbow lorikeet, right? A butcher bird. Look at the hooked tip of that beak. These are partly carnivorous birds. They will tear apart little vertebrate animals and eat them up. And then galahs. Beautiful birds. They really are. Thank you, Sir Yogi. Good stuff. Lairtrop says, photo taken from my backyard yesterday. Eastern Rosella made some very strange noises while I was making a cup of tea. You've got incredible birds down there. You really do. Oh, man. I can see why so many birders from around the world like to visit Australia. Your birds are like... they almost look made up sometimes. It's like something that some like AI program would generate. Colorful bird in tree. Psst, there you go. But they're real. They're really real. Really neat. Lairtrop, really neat. Rosand has got... who is this? Oh. A black swan. Very cool. That's really neat, Rosand. That's really neat. A black swan. Oh, in New Zealand, though it did come from Australia. Oh, okay. Gotcha, Layer T. Well, Oceania, I should say. The continent of Oceania has some wild birds. And I mean wild in that those birds are... something up with them. In the Northern Territories, crocs might get ya. Oh, good on ya, Alexander Morrison. Watch out for the fishies, especially the salties. And Starling Fan. Oh man, Starling Fan, we've got, speaking of starling mimicry, we've got a starling alert. Let me see if I can find you the... we talk about starlings fairly often here on this channel.
Gonna give him a kiss.
Gonna give him a kiss.
Gonna give him a kiss.
Yeah.
Gonna give him a kiss.
Mm. My sweet turd bird.
Who's my precious jabby bird?
Yeah.
Who's my precious jabby bird?
Who's my precious jabby bird?
Who's my sweet jabby angel? Who's my sweet jabby angel?
Starling fan, have you read the book Mozart's Starling? By Leonda Lynn Hoped? Have you read this book? It's an incredible book. You're gonna love it.
The idea for this book was really sudden, actually. I had heard about the story of Mozart's starling for years, probably even decades. But one day I was looking out the window of this study and a flock of starlings appeared on the grass, and I just became obsessed with the notion that this brilliant composer had as a companion this very common and what is in our country a reviled bird. Here they're a non-native invasive species. Conservationists like me, nature writers like me, are supposed to hate starlings. So that sort of dissonance was very interesting to me. So
lovely book.
I flew to Salzburg, I flew to Vienna, I read all of his biographies and his letters, and then perhaps the craziest thing I did was rescue a 5-day-old starling chick and raise her in our household. This is Carmen. She's four years old now, and she is very much a part of our life. I don't know if she's part of our human family or we're her starling flock. I think it's actually a little bit of both.
Yeah. Lovely book. I would highly recommend it. Exquisite writing. Beautiful story. I learned a lot. It's good stuff. Here, moving on. I need to wrap this up ASAP. Neilf has got a male Wilson's plover trying to impress females. A little dance display. If she is happy, they will have a nest soon. That's really lovely. I love beach birds. Shorebirds are so cool. Yeah, and we'll do MetaZoo another time, Patrick Crusader. I literally need to leave in a couple minutes to go on a road trip. So we're gonna be wrapping up very, very soon. Thank you, Neilf. I will hopefully be seeing some plovers where I'm going. I've got a Cooper's Hawk from Psychanalis. That is lovely. What a beautiful photo. Look at that. The majesty of this bird right here. Oh, man. Yeah. Very nice, Psychanalis. Very, very nice. And Therian, last but not least, has got some Meleagris Gallopavo. All these are in my front yard. The turkeys like to hang out with my pet goat. Oh, and there's a red-headed woodpecker? What kind of woodpecker is this? Very cool. Turkeys and goat. I like that they tolerate each other. Super cool. We'll be talking a lot about turkeys in November, leading up to Thanksgiving. I'm not a fan of turkeys for eating, but I'm very much a fan of turkeys as living dinosaurs. And I put together an infographic about this a few years ago, which is downloadable. You can download it and print it out, give it to your friends and colleagues and enemies. But your turkey, like all birds, is a living dinosaur. All of these features which make birds unique among modern creatures. From their hollow bones, to the shape of their neck, to the structure of their ankle joint or their wrist, to their wishbone, even to their feathers. Each one of these different things that is totally unique among modern animals, just to birds, didn't used to be unique. Because each of those features are dinosaur features that birds inherited. Including the wishbone, including the feathers, including their unique respiratory system. Those are evolutionary hand-me-downs from their dinosaur forebears. And this chart helps outline that. And I recommend laminating it and using it as a placemat for Thanksgiving dinner. Or any other time when people might be dissecting bird carcasses for some sort of ritual feast or sumptuous pagan ritual or whatever you people do. I don't know. I'm a vegetarian. I think all that stuff's weird. But you know what? More power to you. Especially if it helps you learn about dinosaur anatomy. Anyway, with that said, let's go ahead and bring an Archaeopteryx up here for our credits to roll over. And I gotta wrap this up. I will not be streaming tomorrow. I'm going on a little road trip. I'm going to take a bunch of photos, and I will be very excited to share this with you on Monday, when I'll be streaming next. But thank you, everybody, for helping us reach and exceed our sub-goal this week. Thank you for your enthusiasm and your questions and your wonderful bird photos and just the sense of camaraderie that we have here. I appreciate you. Every single one of you who's appearing by name in our credits, and you lurkers and anybody else who's here. To see you again very soon. Let's see who else is on Twitch right now, hopefully doing some science. I'll do a quick raid and run. And, you know, in honor of California, in order of Thursday Birds Day, let's raid California Burbs while it's still daylight. And let's go see some birds. There's a squirrel right now. Oh, and a bunch of birds. Very nice. Well, well, well. Thank you, everybody, again. Including the lovely Thug Shells for that raid. I really appreciate it. And I hope to see everybody back here on Monday. I'll show you some photos from my trip. I'm going to visit one of the coolest aquariums in the entire world. And I'll have some photos to share with you. Until then, everybody, you take care of yourselves. Let's go check out Thursday Bird's Day. I'll see you there.